Hey, welcome back to the Personality Hacker Podcast. My name is Joel Mark Witt.
And I'm Antonia Dodge.
In May of 1954, Roger Bannister did something that had never been done, at least never been recorded, in the history of the world. He ran an entire mile in less than 4 minutes. And up until that point, on the 6th of May in 1954, it was believed that running a mile less than 4 minutes was impossible. It was a belief that everyone had. And since that time period, multiple people have been able to run a mile shorter than 4 minutes. And really nothing's changed. Like, a mile has always been, by humans, able to be run less than 4 minutes. But it took Roger Bannister to prove that to us and to give us that belief for other people to follow in his footsteps.
So the last podcast we did was on becoming an excellent communicator. We took a model, the success model from the book Made to Stick, to empower people to look for tools to communicate their mission or the thing that they believe is really important to them. And what we've noticed is that it's not even so much about having tools to be able to communicate a mission if you have something that's burning in your heart that you believe the world truly needs to know. We've observed that the thing that holds people back is not lack of tools, although that can be one component. It's generally a belief that they are somehow disqualified from being the kind of person who can have a mission or accomplish their mission or do the big thing that they want to do for the world. And so I think the reason why Joel, your example of the 4 minute mile is so powerful is this podcast is going to be about or around limiting beliefs. It's going to be around the things we tell ourselves are not possible for us that actually are possible. And one of the most powerful ways to get around a limiting belief is to look at examples of people doing what we have thought is impossible. But let's first talk about what a limiting belief is, some ways in which it holds us back, and then let's talk about this concept of utilizing examples of people doing the quote-unquote impossible to inspire us to bigger things in our life.
I don't think it's possible to really do anything in life unless you believe it can be done. I mean, really, that seems really basic, right? Like, I can't go do the dishes downstairs in my house unless I believe that dishes can be done downstairs in my house. Like, I've got to believe that first before it can even be done. That's like a super basic level of what we're talking about. And then just extend that to anything. Anything that you do in life, before you did that, you had to think about doing that. You had to say, okay, it's possible for me to go drive that place or do that activity. Like, that's just how life works. Our minds have to conceive it before we can actually make it happen. And so when we're talking about beliefs, it's almost like beliefs drive everything that's possible for us. Everything we engage in, we had to have a belief around that being possible first, and then we can go and do it. And so if we have a lot of limitations on how we perceive things to be possible or the belief around what's possible, now we might be synthetically holding ourselves back from doing excellent things in life just because we're like, oh, well, that's not possible. Like, our minds haven't conceived it yet. And on the reverse, if our minds can conceive something, oftentimes it's a possibility. In fact, some people teach that anytime your mind can actually conceive something, it is a possibility, like time travel. I've not seen it shown up yet, but people believe because as humans we can imagine this, it's possible in life.
One of the most insidious ideas that we end up adopting, and by adopting I mean like it was a bastard child out there that we ended up taking in and rescuing somehow and protecting it and making it our own, are these limiting beliefs or beliefs that something can't happen based entirely on conjecture. So a limiting belief is anytime you tell yourself that something is impossible and then give yourself a fill-in-the-blank story around why it's not possible. Limiting beliefs are disempowering. They are narratives that we spin. They are stories we tell ourselves that justify inactivity or justify taking the path of least resistance. And limiting beliefs are very insidious because our brains are so good at constructing a very reasonable, analytical, detailed excuse for why it can't happen. we get so good at spinning these narratives. We get so good at going, well, I can't do that because, and then we might have something like so buttoned up, so locked down, so beautifully narrated that completely illustrates why it's not possible in my case. And limiting beliefs are the reason why they're so insidious is because we're so good at creating them.
I'm going to pick on you a little bit and I'm going to get real concrete here. You have in the last few months had a limiting belief. You've said out loud to me and to yourself, you've said with a child, I don't believe I can build a business. I don't believe we can do this. I don't believe we're going to be able to do the and accomplish the goals that we have because we've got this child that's so needy and needs my time and attention. And I can't focus on what I need to focus on because I've got this kid. And you have a belief around this. This is something that comes up for you a lot. And we'll talk about this and we'll work with this. And you'll say, yeah, it's over. I got to give up on this business sometimes. Like some days it's obviously hyperbolic or you're at the end of your rope because she's so frustrating for you that day. But that's a limiting belief that you're bringing to the table around building this business together.
Yeah, absolutely. It is easily my biggest limiting belief right now. And it's like the last in a long line of limiting beliefs. I've had limiting beliefs around all sorts of things. I'm not qualified for fill in the blank because of fill in the blank. So many limiting beliefs. And some of them really were not mine to begin with. Some of them were my parents' limiting beliefs that I simply adopted. I just didn't question them and I assumed that that was reality. Some of them were limiting beliefs that society told me. It's just not possible to do whatever it is I want to do because people don't do that kind of thing. Some of the limiting beliefs come from myself, from my fears around failure or my fears around success. Limiting beliefs are justifications for not going for what you want. And like I said, they're so insidious because they feel so reasonable. My belief around not being able to build this business or being able to have a mission and really accomplish big things in the world, having influence, etc., because I have a 3.5-year-old, is, I mean, if you ask me all the reasons why I can't build this business because I have a toddler, I could give you a million of them. You know, we have a particularly headstrong child. She's not very accommodating. She's very needy with attention. She's very aggressive. She has a very like naturally angry personality type. And so we have to do a lot of working with her. She doesn't play by herself very much. And so I have a lot of like all my energy is going to this kid. Childcare is difficult to set up. Babysitters cancel. I was supposed to be writing and I got halfway through the article, the blog post, and in comes Piper. And now my attention and focus is diffused. And now it's going to take me forever to get back into focus. It's like, I have a million reasons why I know I'm right and I have in this limiting belief. And yet that's the point of the belief. The belief is a buttoned up excuse for my frustrations and why I kind of want to give up. Like, I'm like, I kind of want to give up. I don't want to do this anymore. I don't want to have to like battle with these two factions. Wonderful example of a concrete limiting belief that is effectively BS. And yet it's a reality that I live with. I watch people have limiting beliefs all the time. And when I look at the limiting beliefs that other people manifest or show up with or give me, it's so easy for me to go, that's just a limiting belief. Like, that's just like, you're just telling yourself you can't do it. That's ridiculous. You can totally do it. Just do this and this and this. And yet when I reflect it back onto myself, that is like, I cerebrally know that. I know that that's true on some level. And yet in my day-to-day life, my limiting belief feels so real to me. And I think that's one of the reasons why we wanted to really tackle this concept is because we know that when you have one of these beliefs, they are so real to you. It is so true in your case. It's like, there's just really no way out. I've seen a lot of people, I just recently read a thread on Reddit. I love Reddit and I go on Reddit every day. It's like my primary news source. And one of the threads I recently read on Reddit was it was like a series of pictures that somebody had taken from a sailing trip that they did from, I believe it was like Port Angeles, Washington, or like way North Washington down to Mexico or to even possibly South America. I'm trying to remember exactly where. And they had this series of pictures of the trips and they had stories around them and some of the, you know, frustrations they had and some of the hairy times, but all these like really beautiful pictures. And there was a conversation in the thread where people were talking about, because the caption was, you know, guy quits his job, buys a boat, and sails from Washington to Mexico. And the conversation within the thread was like, yeah, right. Like, he just quit his job and bought a boat. He was probably a trust fund baby. Or he probably had this, like, super high-paying job, and that's the only reason why he was able to afford a boat. And then there's conversations around how expensive boats were, and conversations around how expensive travel was. And there was all this conversation around, or, like, these people basically saying, there's no way that I could ever do that. Right? Like that's not reality. You should just find whatever happiness you can find in your day job and try to be satisfied with that. Like, that was the top comment. The top comment was, just try to find some happiness in your day job and stop having these pie in the sky, you know, thoughts about sailing around the world. And I'm like, whoa, that is a crazy, strong, like, collective, unconscious, limiting belief that we have in our society.
Oh, yeah.
That is a crazy powerful one, and that one comes up over and over. If you try to, like, if you try to quit your job to start a business, many people will come out of the woodwork telling you how stupid an idea that is. Because you're threatening this idea that that's possible, and if that's possible for one person, it might be possible for everybody. And so when you show examples of successful businesses, those same people with the limiting beliefs will have all sorts of reasons why it was possible in that one individual person's case, but definitely not in my case, and definitely not in everybody's case. Really powerful, so, like, socially constructed, socially bought into limiting beliefs. And we just slurp these up. We think, oh, that must be how reality is. That must be how it works. Oh, I must not be able to do that myself. And we buy into it. We start buying into these stories about how things are not possible. And yet we see examples all the time of how stuff is possible. I know somebody, I'm on the mailing list of somebody who has literally traveled to every country on the planet. He's literally traveled to every country on the planet. He's not independently wealthy. He wasn't a trust fund baby. He just decided he was going to do that. That was a goal of his and he accomplished it. Why can he do it and I can't do it, right?
Yeah.
So these limiting beliefs get so, they're so powerful too, not only because there's a lot of rationale around them, but also because everybody's got them and they swap them back and forth with each other. And they go, this is how reality works, right? Oh yeah, that's totally how reality works. And they wink and then they nudge at each other and they go, okay, a justification for taking the path of least resistance. And if we want to accomplish big things in the world, if we want to get missions accomplished and actually push the trajectory of the planet towards more positive outcomes, then we got to let go of our bullshit limiting beliefs. We have to let them go. We have to stop distracting ourselves with these justifications, distracting ourselves with things that make the path of least resistance a little more comfortable for us.
You know, the best cure is prevention. And one of the things that I've really worked on in my life is to be diligent, and I think you have too, Antonio, be diligent about not allowing limiting beliefs come into my field in the first place. Because once you get these things rattling in your head, it's a lot of personal growth and work to eradicate them from your experience, from your reality. Like, there are narratives that are powerful running narratives in your systems, right? Your mental systems, your processing systems in your mind. So one of the best places to start is to stop allowing these to come in the first place. If you are in conversation with your family at Thanksgiving or the holidays, whatever holidays in your country, and, you know, your uncle starts talking about how the economy's bad and no one can start a business because it's difficult now, and maybe you've dreamed about starting your own business, literally getting up and leaving the room so that that belief structure is not starting to get into your unconscious mind is one of the places that you can start this process of being vigilant, of being very careful on your inputs, on the input mechanisms that you have, and guarding the gates of your mind first, because those limiting beliefs usually come from somewhere else. We don't usually just, like, all of a sudden start popping up. We can, but oftentimes limiting beliefs are adopted. They're not really from us. They're not internally structured. They're actually coming from the outside world. People that we respect, maybe our parents, they may have given us limiting beliefs about safety or security when we were little, or we saw our parents fight and now we've got a limiting belief about the potentiality for great relationships because they weren't in a great relationship. And as a kid, it's hard to really understand to filter these out. But as you get older and you start understanding how personal development works and how these beliefs come about, being vigilant at the gates of your mind is important. And if you can short circuit those coming in the first place, you're going to have a much easier time. Now you can put your energy toward getting rid of the other stuff that's already in there than continually battling things coming in. So one thing I'd encourage you to do is don't be lazy about your inputs. Be vigilant, be on top of them, because they are going to impact the stuff you're going to have to work on in the internal mechanisms. Again, do radical things. Tony and I don't have a television. We don't like to watch news. We hate watching like news channels and TV because we feel like it's just heightening an awareness of unsafe and fearful beliefs about the world. We believe that news gives us a more fearful stance to the world. So we said, how are we going to reconcile this? And we've got news coming at us, giving us this fearful nature of the world. Oh, you got to be scared of terrorists and you got to be scared of the economy and you got to be scared of this. I know. Let's just remove that element completely. Let's just remove the input ability of that element to get to our minds in the first place. And now we have a lot less work to eradicate those bad beliefs that could come through that channel. So pay attention. What channels do you have turned on right now? I'm not talking about literal TV channels, but whatever input channels you've got. Are you around people who are propagating beliefs that aren't helpful to you? Are you around family or friends? Maybe it's your spouse or children or the things you watch or the things that you're engaged with or the things you're reading. This is a great place to start. And being proactive and preventative around these is going to be your first barrier of entry in getting this handled in your life.
Sometimes we don't recognize what our limiting beliefs are. And a great way to understand what some of your limiting beliefs might be is, what do you have resistances around when somebody suggests an alternative to what you're doing? If you've got something that, and sometimes a limiting belief can come from having tried over and over to accomplish something and having got knocked down a lot. We can create limiting beliefs based on our experiences if we have found ourselves failing a lot. You know, we've failed and failed and failed and failed. And so we've told ourselves, yeah, that one's just not possible for me. It's possible for other people, but it's not possible for me. And if somebody goes, no, it's possible for you, and you immediately resist, you're like, no, that one's not possible for me. Possible for other people, but not for me. You've got a limiting belief. That's what it is. And the one of the best ways to find your way out of this pit, because it can feel like a pit, is to recognize how much protection you have around the belief. If you've got a fortress of walls up, if you've got a lot of different justifications ready made, if there's something where somebody goes, oh, hey, you should go do this thing, and you've got like 10 reasons ready made why you can't do it, that means you're highly protective of your limiting belief. It means you're harboring it. Harboring as in like the actual definition of harbor, which is to protect ships. You're protecting this limiting belief. And generally the reason why we protect limiting beliefs or create a harbor for them is because the pain of getting back up on the saddle is too much for us to consider. It means we have trauma. It means that we have some healing work to do around whatever pain we experienced in the past. So sometimes we protect limiting beliefs because, not just because it's a path of least resistance, but because we actually have some healing work to do there. Our growth means that we have to address the healing work that we haven't yet addressed. So sometimes limiting beliefs can be a great indicator of what our next growth project should be. But most of our limiting beliefs aren't just based on repeated failures. Most of our limiting beliefs are, as Joel mentioned, they're adopted. And a great story that exemplifies how this can happen when we adopt a limiting belief is, I think, the one that is most often used to as a metaphor for this, is how elephants are treated when they're young in order to keep them close to, you know, the village or whoever is training them. They will take a small elephant and tie their leg up against a pole that is like a stake in the ground or a tree that the small elephant cannot get away from. So the elephant tries and tries and tries and tries to get away from this pole, but it can't because it's, or a tree, because it's too deeply rooted in the ground. By the time the elephant becomes full grown, that tree is no impediment. That pole is no impediment. They could just easily rip the tree or the pole out of the ground and walk off. But they were so conditioned when they were young to believe that the rope around the tree means that they can't go anywhere, that all the trainer will have to do is tie a rope around their tree and put it against, like, I mean, just a twig practically, and the elephant will stay in place. Because they got conditioned when they were young to believe that that rope means they are not going anywhere. So as an adult, the limitations that they had as children is no longer relevant, but they don't know that. So a way that limiting beliefs happen too is over time, maybe we tried something when we were at an earlier level of development. Maybe we actually were children, or maybe we're just at an earlier level of our growth. But we got conditioned to believe that something was not possible for us at that earlier stage. And so at this later stage of development or growth, we don't even try. We just assume that we're not able to do it. So one of the strategies for getting rid of limiting beliefs is to recognize that that limiting belief might actually be accurate at a certain time period in our life, but it's not a static thing. It actually, we grow and change over time, and our abilities grow and change over time. So give it another shot. And if we can't do it now, it just might be that we're not big enough, we're not full grown enough in our development to be able to pull the tree out of the ground. But you might be in the future, you might continue to grow and then be totally capable of doing it in the future. So it's not necessarily saying that all things are possible at all times. It's saying that things are possible if I can grow into a place where it's possible. So I'm going to keep trying. I'm going to do some development work, some healing work, some achievement work, and I'm going to give it a shot. And if it doesn't happen, well, then I just have to keep growing, just like the elephant has to keep getting bigger. And then I can try again when I've done a little bit more growth and development. And pretty soon I will be ready for this thing. It's not a matter of, again, all things being possible to all people at all times. It's that we simply need to grow into a time period or a space in which it is now possible.
You know, and the reverse can be true as well. You can have some initial success at something and you got, maybe it was luck or you were in the right place at the right time, or you were a big fish in a small pond, and then you get into a different context and now you're frustrated and you all of a sudden begin to develop a belief. I think of the story about Walt Disney, who was working in Kansas City as a cartoonist for a theater. He was just doing cartoons before movies would screen. And he decided that he wanted to move to Los Angeles to become a movie director and to get into movies. He went to Los Angeles. Well, he actually wanted to get into animation. He went because that's what he did. So he got to Los Angeles in like 1922 or something, early 1920s. And he had some success. Like his cartoons were selling in Kansas City. He wanted to like scale up. He gets to LA and he realizes there's animation studios already set up in Hollywood at the time. Like Hollywood was just on the growth curve. And he walked around to these different animation studios trying to get jobs. And he came back to his brother Roy and said, I think I'm going to go into just regular film directing because everything in animation that could be done has been done. Like all the growth, all the advancements, all the great things in animation, it's already been done. Like there's nothing new for me to contribute in this field. And he and his brother, through conversation, his brother encouraged him to, no, let's give this a try. And obviously we know the Walt Disney Company and Walt Disney himself made tons of advancements in animation. He made tons of advancements. And now we've got other companies like Pixar that are blowing out of the water what's possible with film animation. But at the time, because he had some initial success, he gets to another context and says, oh, maybe I was a little premature in thinking this was possible. And he had a limiting belief around what was able to be done in this field. And so he had to think through and change his perspective in this narrative to say, no, this is possible. I can do this. And he started pushing the envelope technically and artistically in this framework. So I think that's a great example of it going the other way too.
Yeah. In order to really, truly graduate from limiting beliefs, I think awareness is huge. Understanding what your limiting beliefs are is huge. Seeing where they emerge, what's the system from which this belief emerged? What are the components of that? Is it something that was adopted? Is it something based on having tried and failed a couple times and you're just not ready yet? Is it based on, you know, a fear of failure or a fear of success? Is it based on just pure fears? Is it based on conditioning? There are a lot of different reasons why you might have this limiting belief, and being able to dissect it and figure out the source, the etymology of it, is very powerful. But that's the diagnosis. The prescription is this: be around people that will not tolerate limiting beliefs. Simply surround yourself with people who make sure that every time they spot a limiting belief, they call it out. And that's really frustrating at first. I've been in that space where I had a bunch of limiting beliefs, and every time I say one, somebody goes, well, that just sounds like a limiting belief. And eventually I just wanted to punch all those people. I was like, yes, but it's my life. Like, that's where I'm at. Stop saying everything's a limiting belief. However, being around a context of people who just kept going, yeah, that's a limiting belief, eventually got it through my thick skull that, yeah, you're right. It is just a belief. It's just a limiting belief. So being around people who won't tolerate it is pretty huge.
I do that with my boys. Every time they use the word can't, I'm like, stop using the word can't. You haven't even tried this yet. You're already preceding the fact you can't do this. You're limiting the belief around doing this thing. Gunner, stop this. Just don't use the word can't. I'm like, don't use can't. And they get very frustrated with me. Like, it's annoying to them for me to do this. And even in conversation with us, well, I think language is important in this. I'll say, so I've got a problem with, and I'll stop. And I'll be like, actually, I have a challenge with. And just using a real quick turn of phrase instead of a problem, it's a challenge. It's not like something to overcome. And just that little switch in thinking, this little switch in language can change your like lockdown on this belief versus something that's more fluid. Again, this flexibility, this fluidity of belief.
To add to that is, or if you can't find people who will call you on your limiting beliefs, which sometimes happens, you just don't have that context. Another thing that is very powerful and wonderful if you supplement it with the first, which is surrounding yourself with people who won't tolerate it. But regardless of whether or not you can do that, either supplementing or simply utilizing this, is using people who have done the quote-unquote impossible as inspiration. The 4-minute mile, going to the moon, almost single-handedly, not quite single-handedly, but almost single-handedly doing a leading a charge that completely changes civil rights in this country. There are so many different examples of people who have done what would have otherwise been considered impossible and using them as inspiration. Recognizing that whatever you want to do, you have as a human being, you have the genetic makeup to make it happen. And so it's just a matter of figuring it out. It's a matter of growing into the position or training into the position, making it happen. Now, there are certain things that feel less possible than other things. If you're a 40-year-old that wants to start training for the Olympics, that might be kind of a tough, you know, gig, because most people have been training for the Olympics, have been doing it since they were 4 years old. So there's some pretty, like, that's quite improbable. And yet, that doesn't mean it can't happen. Right? Like, we just haven't seen it happen yet, but that doesn't mean it can't happen. And if you shoot for that, even if you don't make it to the Olympics, look at how far you've come. So it's not really a matter of like attaching to an end game, attaching to how something looks very specifically and going, I can never possibly do that. Or going, I'm absolutely going to do that. It's more setting our intentions for greatness, setting our intentions for something big, communicating something powerful to the world like a mission, and then not talking ourselves out of it, talking ourselves into it, and figuring out what it is that we need to do in order to be qualified to make it happen.
I was talking with someone who is deeply religious recently, and I totally get their perspective because I used to be here in my own life. And I was talking about nanobot technology. And I said, you know, the technology is already existent and they're testing it for nanobots to be injected into the human body and basically go repair cells at the cellular level. As humans, we could potentially in the next, 100 years, developing this technology, live indefinitely because we can repair our body cells. Like, we won't die as people unless there's like an accident, like we get a car accident or something. We can extend life indefinitely by using technology. And I remember the person looking at me and say, well, that can't be true because the Bible says that, we all are destined to die. And that's a belief they have that is in direct contrast to a technology that's being developed right now. And I could even see people like in legislation and when they're making policies about legalizing certain technologies based on our development as people saying, well, we can't legalize this technology because it goes against the belief I already hold about how long a person can live. And this is what we're talking about. I know that's like if you're a deeply religious person, spiritual person, you might have umbrage with what I'm saying because I'm kind of throwing this up saying, well, you might have a belief that's saying something that's very radically different than what reality is showing you. But step back for a moment and see what's going on there, because that might extend to other smaller things in your life. But that's like a big example of a limiting belief that might be hijacking technological progress just because it's so different and radical from what they thought was possible in the initial outset of their lives.
Yeah. And I don't think most of these are incompatible beliefs.
We think they are, though. I mean, people think they are.
Yeah, exactly. Like, I think a lot of our limiting beliefs are because we think we're supposed to have a belief, like you said.
Like a false dichotomy of sorts.
Exactly. So some of our limiting beliefs are trying to be loyal to belief systems. I agree with that. And yet, most of the time when we have a limiting belief and the rationalization around that in that kind of context, usually we're creating a false dichotomy that doesn't actually exist. It's not really an incompatible belief system. So limiting beliefs can come from lots of different places. And I think some of the most powerful components are basically don't synthetically limit yourself. Like, get around people who won't allow limiting beliefs. Use people who have done the quote-unquote impossible as inspiration. Question yourself as to why you might feel this way. Question yourself as to what the etymology is and whether or not you actually agree with that etymology. Like, do I actually agree that I can't do this thing? Or maybe I was just conditioned to believe that. Ask yourself if you're being loyal to a belief system that this other belief is actually not incompatible, but you think that it might be, and you're trying to be loyal to something else. So really dissecting this, really being aware of it, having awareness around how it can look, and then not allowing it, like finding strategies and tools to get through it. Finding strategies and tools to scale up and try again, and then if you're not ready for that time period, then just keep scaling up. Finding all these different ways to empower yourself to actually reach out for something bigger and better is, we believe, is very instrumental in actually refocusing the world's attention to solving challenges, to actually being able to give, like, have an increased quality of life for everyone. We feel like getting rid of, or at least acknowledging and graduating from limiting beliefs, we feel like that's probably one of the most important components to actually getting these missions accomplished.
What are your limiting beliefs? As we're talking, what's coming up for you? What are some things you've identified in the midst of this conversation you've had with us that you're like, wow, I wonder if that's something that's limiting me. I have a belief around this thing. Or are there limiting beliefs that you've conquered? You've said, you know, I'm not going to believe this about myself or what's possible anymore. I'm going to shift my reality. And you've seen growth, or you've seen change in your life. You've seen something incredible happen. Or have you had a failure in it, or a setback where you've changed your belief and it didn't work out for you? We'd love to hear about all of these. Come over to personalityhacker.com. You can leave a question, a comment, give feedback, join this conversation right below this podcast. And we want to know about your personal experience. It's important that your voice is heard because you're part of this community. You're part of this conversation. And we'd love to get your feedback and your perspective. You can also join our community of like minds, people just like you, over at facebook.com/personalityhacker, or you can find us on twitter.com/personalityhack.
If you enjoyed this podcast, you can subscribe to us on iTunes and various Android platforms. And if you're feeling a sense of reciprocity and would like to do a kindness for us, please leave a rating review on iTunes.
Absolutely. My name is Joel Mark Witt.
And I'm Antonia Dodge.
We will talk with you on the next Personality Hacker podcast.